What's the complicated thing here is your heart. All right. So I'll start with my presentation because, you know, I would want some points maybe for you to consider. You could also take notes if required. And I'll keep coming back for some interactive part. Okay. So let me start off with this. The first concept is, you know, I said, what is the most important thing is that you are enterprising. Entrepreneurs are supposed to be enterprising people. Okay. All other things can be, like organized, arranged, learned, everything. But the enterprising part will have to be there. You will have to be somebody who is, dynamic, somebody who is, taking things in a way that is self-driven. Okay. So let me start off with, I like to make it interactive. So I will ask you a particular question and I want you to just type. You can just type a single alphabet, actually, because I'm putting before you two words and I'm asking you which is more important. So the two words are needs and wants. So whoever thinks needs, you can just type N, and if you say wants, you put W. What do you think is more important, needs or wants? Okay, so needs, everyone apparently agrees on that, right? Now, I want to ask you the question, if you think needs are more important than wants, suppose you are hungry, okay? Hunger is a need and you can fulfill that need by eating atta. Will you eat it? You will want that atta bit to be turned into some sort of a bread or a roti, before you eat it. You can eat it, you can survive. We can, eat leaves and survive. We were types of animals who could eat, vegetables and leaves and survive, roots. It's later on that we began to cook our food and we also began to eat things that we could otherwise digest by cooking it. We have evolved as animals, but our need can be fulfilled of hunger by just plain anything, right? But we won't eat it. Now, what I'm trying to bring before you is, if a human being is eating, say, from a dustbin, he's doing it because he needs it, not because he wants it. And human beings are driven by wants all the time. The differentiation between animals and us, we are also animals, but the differentiation between other animals and us is that we are driven by wants. And all human beings who are driven by needs only are either, in a sad situation because of not having opportunity, or they are lesser as human beings in the sense, so we allow our needs to drive us. Okay, we should have our wants. Now, what are wants? Wants are aspirations. And entrepreneurship will begin with this very most important quality. You must want to be an entrepreneur. You shouldn't become an entrepreneur because you need it. Because you need it, you may take a job, right? You may work for somebody. But entrepreneurship is about being your own boss, being the person in charge, small or big, whatever it is. You are in charge. And that's a very wonderful thing, So what I will do now is I will, just define in a very simple way, a technical definition of entrepreneurship is the activity of designing, launching, and running a new business or businesses, taking on financial risk in the hope of profit. Okay. So this is a very technical. So you have to design. So what you can do from now on is start designing. And maybe some of you will launch it when you're in college also, or maybe you'll launch it later. But you start designing now. And I will focus on helping you do that, because the launching and the running is something that, you know, you can be helped with, you know, by a lot of different types of mentoring and this and that. The designing, you know, initially at least, nobody can help you without being clear why you, what you want to do as an entrepreneur. Okay, so what is that activity? What is that product that you want to create, maybe, or what is the service that you want to provide? And for that, like, if you know any of you have got any ideas, you could probably, you know, start sharing them. Or you can share them in the chat. So, anyone has any ideas for business? Why? I'll put it in a maybe a different way. You know, entrepreneurship is when you solve some problem. Anything you do as entrepreneurship, you know, because see, people will pay you for, you know, like a product or a service if it is solving some problem of theirs. So, you know, if you want to find out what to do, you just look around and you find out. So if you think, see, like in the lockdown, you know, there were people needed vegetables and fruits and other groceries to be dropped home. You know, they wanted it to reach home. They wanted maybe food to reach home, cooked food, maybe cakes, biscuits, pastries. And a lot of entrepreneurs started there, right? Doing those things. Because that was a problem. People couldn't step out. They were scared to step out. And they wanted somebody would come and give it at their gate. And they, you know, and something that could happen. And people, and there were many people who, you know, like started doing that, those type of businesses, right? But you know, some people are doing that even from before. Like I know a pharmacy guy who's doing very well in where I stay. Right from the time he established, he had some sort of this for senior citizens, you know, where, you know, he would pick up a locality, like say, you know, 3-4 colonies at a time, and or, you know, like housing colonies or whatever, and they would go around delivering what was ordered by the senior citizens in those colonies. So he just identified that the senior citizens don't, it's not easy for them to travel and come to the pharmacy. So he was taking the medicines to their homes, and he was doing it much, much before the lockdown, for at least 7 or 8 years since he launched his business. And he's doing very well because of that. A lot of people are very happy to, you know, like have some sort of a service like this. So if anyone has any ideas, or even you can even put out your mic and speak, not a problem. You can tell me so that, you know, maybe I could use that in the examples, and probably it would help you much more, especially the person whose idea it is. Yes? I can't see anything. Okay, fine. Maybe I'm probably presuming now that you don't have any idea, but now what I will suggest to you is, if you want to do entrepreneurship, you will have to start identifying what you want to do. It could be quite general, you know, and then you'll start focusing, but you need to have something. I had heard this line, you know, from a scripting person, you know, somebody who used to write plays. And he said, when you write, you write. Because you can edit what you have written. Okay. Otherwise, you just keep waiting for it to happen. So he said, just write whatever you want to write, and then you can change it, right? You can change it fully. You can change it a bit. You can add to it. You can detract. You can, you know, adapt, innovate, whatever. So many things you can do. But you need to have it. So you need to identify what I want to do. You know, like I'll give an example. You know, I want to say, do something in clothes. Right? So I start with that. Like, you know, I'll say, maybe I start off with saying that I want to sell ready-mades. Then maybe I may shift to, no, I don't want to this thing, sell ready-mades. I want to sell a fashion brand. Or maybe I can go to that. I will sell for, you know, costume dramas and for fancy dress parties. You know, I'll probably provide that. And, you know, I can start choosing things like this. Right? This is a wonderful thing. In fact, you know, like I've been to Kerala, to Calicut, and there are many, many such businesses there, you know, where even if you go to buy, say you go to buy, you go and see a shirt piece, right? And it's stitched and given to you in less than 12 hours. Less than 12 hours they come to you. I mean, I even had occasions when I've got it in around 4 or 5 hours. But their commitment is less than 12 hours. And basically they come and deliver it to your hotel. And you know, if it's not okay, they, some alteration has to be done, they do that and get it back very fast. Now, imagine, like, you know, like I remember, you know, for quite some time I hadn't bought cloth. But when I now I go, if I go to Calicut, you know, like I go to that specific place, but there are many other places where I'll go and, you know, like I'll pick up the cloth and I'll say, stitch it to my size, right? And it's like a ready made, but it is my choice, you know. And it's a wonderful thing. It works out very well, you know, when we go as a training team and, you know, there are four, that's how it happened the first time. There are five of us and we, you know, we had gone with same color shirts, but we still bought another two colors there, you know. Similar shirts, we all stitched for ourselves and we all got them in less than 12 hours. So now that becomes, or you know, like there's one lady who got into from Margao, you know, she got into providing uniforms, Taylor Bird. Okay, she provides uniforms for schools, higher secondaries, for, you know, like industry. And it's a major activity, meaning, you know, she has more than 30 girls working for her and some 15 men, and the men are mainly tailors and you know, like the transport people, you know, who carry the stuff here and there. But the ladies are the ones who go and take the measurements, who take the payments, who come and do the cutting. The stitching is done by the tailors, but they do the cutting, they deliver it, they ensure that it's correct, and you know, like now this is a service and it's a flourishing business. Okay. And I want you to keep this in mind, you know, that if you want to think of entrepreneurship, you will have to think of some idea. And if you think of that idea, then you start ideating and developing that idea. And how you can do that, I will suggest, you know, with a very simple analogy. Okay, I'm saying, like, how you plan the path is by imagining that you're growing a plant. Growing a idea is like growing a plant. So if you want to grow a potted plant, you know, I give you a potted plant and you have to grow it, you know, you have to look after it. What are the things you have to do? You could put them in the type them in the box, or you could tell me. Yes. What are the things you need for a potted plant to grow? What will you do? Water, correct. That's one thing. Make the soil fertile. Okay. Soil and maybe the fertilizer to it is important. Good. Two things. We got two things. Sunlight, good. Then, so sunlight, pot is already there, water, then there is the soil, seed or plant is already there. If the plant is there in the pot, how do we, you know, like, we see, you require to ensure it gets sunlight, it gets water. So check for damage while it's growing and maintain it. So how maintain it? It's a right point, but I want you to develop it slightly, Rylan. How will you maintain it? Pesticide. Okay, pesticide is mentioned. I'll take that as something to be, you know, to remove the unwanted. Fine. And one more thing. Okay, which I'll take as what Rylan is saying, but I'll put it in a slightly different way, is where you take care of it, maybe protect it. Okay, so basically these are five things you require to grow a plant, and these are five things you will require to grow your entrepreneurship idea. So what are the five things? Like, let me put them before you. The first one is, like the sunlight, you have to see the dream and live the passion. Okay, you have to see what you have to do. This is the one which will, you know, like, help you really, really grow. Okay. So like I also like to, you know, like talk about it, like the sunshine, you know, it gives us a lot of you know, warmth and light, right? So I want you to imagine this as your branding and positioning of the business. When I say brand, no, like I'm not talking about the actual branding part, which will come later, but you need to have clarity in your mind. What is it that you're doing? All right. Like, for instance, you know, I started my training business called Unlearning Unlimited only in 2003, but somewhere in 99, I was thinking of doing something like that. I did not have the courage. I was into the profession of architecture and I was quite happy in it, but I was also happy doing training programs, corporate training programs I was doing. But I was realizing that it was a dilemma. You know, I was not being able to do justice to both at the same time. Because if I wanted to do it both professionally, I needed to focus well on one of them. And neither did I have the opportunity to have an architectural office where I had people who could run it for me. I had to be there. I had to go on site. And that would create a lot of pressure on me. You know, if I took up a corporate program and I was to work on it, and I had to go for meetings and this and that. That was quite complicated that time for me in 99. But I had decided that if at all I get into training, it will be called Unlearning. Okay, I eventually called it Unlearning Unlimited. But that was clear to me. And I would do experiential outbound training. I would do training outdoors. All right. So I positioned myself, and that positioning was clear. While all other trainers, you know, most trainers would say we do all types of programs. But I wouldn't say that. I would say I do outbound training programs. So I would take them to the outdoors. I would take them to the forest area. I would take them to the island. I would take them on boats. And, you know, it was slightly different, right? Now this positioning, the branding and the positioning helped. So even when I thought about the logo, I thought about this thing later on, you know, I took help of artists and things like that. It wasn't done by me alone, but the clarity was there in my head is what is the brand? The brand is not to do it in the normal way. Unlearning meant that. So why I'm just giving this example is that if you have this clarity of what is your brand, what is the positioning, you'll find it much, much more, what you'd say, easier to decide what you want to do. Okay. So in the branding and positioning, a lot of things can come, like maybe, you know, like some people can even work on your taglines and how it looks and things like that. Okay. But you need to have, in fact, no, the name of your brand, that at least the name of your business, that has to be clear to you. You may change the name, you know, but you must think of something. Like I told you, see, you have till you actually start it, you have the opportunity to add, alter, detract, you know, adapt, change. You can do all that, but you need to have something. Like I'll repeat that line again. You can't edit something that you don't have, right? You will have to have something. So give it a name. Maybe you can always change it, right? You can change the name. There's not a problem. Maybe you'll get a better name. But you'll get a better name only when you have thought of a particular name. Otherwise, you can't be constantly tentative about it. Then water, you know, water is, you know, the flow of water. There are two parts to water. You know, one is it's adaptive. Water takes color. You can remove color. You can take taste. You can put salt in it, sugar in it. You can remove it out. It can change form from, you know, like solid to liquid to vapor. It can get into any vessel, so to say, right? So water has its flow and water is adaptive. So what you need to do is both these things. You have to be very adaptive, you know, you have to evolve. You have to keep evolving. You have to you have to be ready for, you know, different points of view, listen to them. You need not accept anything, but you need to listen to it. You have to take as much feedback as possible. You need to have good bouncing boards in terms of, you know, people who can give you this help. But the second thing is, besides you know, being adaptive, you have to also have a flow. Okay. So I'll put some points later on, but what I'll tell right now is you need to start putting things down. I would put it like this, you know, get a book, all right, and write everything about this business idea or what you want to do in that book. Start maintaining it, you know, let it not just be in the head, you know, like there's a very famous line saying that don't think, ink it. Okay, and I'll talk about it later also. The third is the soil. Okay, now what the soil and the fertilized soil, the fertile soil represents is that the roots go deep down so the trunk may rise, right? The shoots may rise. The shoots grow because the roots go deep down. All right. So please, you know, like look at it like this. The one who knows is the one who grows. So you need to keep learning. So what do you need to learn? You know, you need knowledge. You need knowledge about, say, for instance, information about the business and things like that. There is this, you know, friend of mine who set up a very successful chain in Goa. And, you know, I'm giving this example because I'm very proud of anyone who runs chains, you know, who is not just in one place, you know, in more than one place. And that's Maxence, you know, Maxence is by Kirit Maganlal. Now, when he wanted to do it, he was young. Their family was into other businesses, fisheries, mining, so many other businesses. And, you know, this was something new that he wanted to do. So he went, you know, he went to Mumbai, he went to Chennai, he tried to find out how they had departmental stores, Akbar Ali's and things like that. He went, he surveyed them, he tried to find out how they work, what type of setup they require, what type of people they require, what are the type of roles, responsibilities, and you know, so many things, including one thing that he found out, and you know, it will make meaning later on when I bring it up again, is that he would require at least 3 or 4 years to start earning. He wouldn't earn before that. Before that, he had to only keep either, you know, like pumping money in the business or running it with almost nil profit, you know, so he wouldn't have his returns coming back. But he was aware of this, you know, and this is very important, that you should have the knowledge. Then there are skills, okay? Most of the skills that you require may be very specific to your business. Like, for instance, you know, like suppose you're getting into, say, the food business, or you're getting into the agro business, or you're getting into garbage, or you're getting into electrification or whatever. There would be certain technical things regarding it, you know, skills, skill sets that you need to this thing. And the wonderful thing now is a lot of this is available online, you know, and it's also available in Goa. There are different, in your premises of Don Bosco, Fathoda, there is fire, you know, and they are people who help entrepreneurs growing. And, you know, these people keep doing, there are other organizations in Goa. They keep doing a lot of training opportunities for skill development and as well as knowledge. So you have to, the one who knows is the one who grows. The fourth thing is of the clipper, you know, removing the unwanted. I'll put it simply. You will have to remove your, what is not good for your, anything in your personal life, your habits, which are not good for your business, you'll have to drop it. Okay. Like, I'll give you an example. You know, if you are getting into, say, the restaurant business, you make a lot of your savings on going and purchasing, you know, ensuring that you are involved in the purchasing or at least monitoring of the purchase of vegetables and food items and things like that. So you make a lot of money by handling that well, you know, so you save money basically. And in business, every penny saved is a penny earned. That is one part. Second part is how you close, you know. So closing is where you have to, you know, like confirm your inventory, confirm the money that has come in, look at it. So you may have people to do a lot of things, but these two things you'll have to put in, you know, you'll have to take this, which means if you're in the restaurant business, You have to wake up early and you have to sleep late in the night. If you have a good team, you can do what you want during the day. Your team can run your business, right? But these two things you will have to look at, because it's very important that you keep a control on this. So, like, suppose I'm just saying, you know, I'm into a restaurant and I'm not a cook, okay? So I don't need to be at the restaurant all the time, right? I can go in between. I'll basically maybe talk to people, you know, I'll interact. And also, you know, like, my presence will help my team, you know, they'll feel I'm also working with them and things like that. But mornings, early mornings, going to the market or monitoring it, even if somebody else is doing, monitoring it, ensuring that you're getting the best quality and you're getting at the best possible rates. So now this is a habit. So you'll have to change it. Okay. Second thing, what I would want you to unlearn is over speaking. Okay. A lot of people into business, they tend to talk more. You have to listen better. All right. So if you listen better, you know what to do, how to deal with the customer. And there are different types of customers. We'll come to that later. So that is one aspect. Then, and the last thing, taking care. This is very important. Whatever you do, all right, there is an element of licensing involved. There is an element of safety involved. And there is an element of also risk, covering your risks, you know, like maybe insurance, maybe taking protection and things like that. You should be able to find out about this. This also is available easily online or by these various organizations who will help you. And you know, they'll all help you. You know why? Because you are, you know, if you grow and your entrepreneurship model works, it's going to be good for everybody. All right. So that is what will be very good for you. I'll get back to the slides for another particular concept that I'll put up before you, and that is how do you go about whatever you're doing, right? 1 minute. So, you know, like, I'm trying to put all these things together, what I have talked. Don't just think, ink it, put it down, have that little book. Take feedback from experts, look at people, you know, who seem to know. When I mean by expert, they may not necessarily be in the business, but they may be in the, they may be good at knowing, like, you know, maybe somebody into accounts and, you know, things like that, or somebody into knowing licensing. Or, you know, like, there are people who have worked, like, you know, I know some people, you know, who have retired, you know, now, but they work in, say, the EDC, which gives loans and things like that. So, you know, you can go and meet these people and they'll be happy to help young people on this thing. You take guidance from the experienced people from the same business. You plan your team, your associate, your investors. This is something I really want to tell you. I didn't do this when I set up my business, and I tell everybody this, that it was a stupid thing to do. You don't run a business with your money, okay? You will require your money maybe when you need to put some more into your business and things like that. I mean, things go wrong, right? Even whatever money you put from your business and from your side, define a particular amount, you know? Like, you say, okay, this is... 30,000 is what I'm going to put in, you know, and you have to have clarity. It can't be like, you know, like, okay, all my money which is there, I'll keep pumping in or something like that. So you need to start looking at investors, and there are various types of investors, right from the government, which is giving a lot of facilities, to other people who may invest in your business, you know, for particular returns. So work on that. Work on your communication skills, all right? What I've noticed is all successful entrepreneurs, they're very good communicators. And that the ability to communicate, you know, like, propels them to greater, what you'd say, opportunities and results. So work on your communication skills, you know, and the college is a wonderful time to do it actually. So every time you talk to somebody, every time you listen, try to, you know, like be a little bit much more focused on it. What are the type of words you use and things like that, you know, like all that starts becoming this thing. Nothing formal about it, okay? If you just think about it, you'll do it. You don't really require too much of help on this from somebody else. You require focus from your side, okay? So one of the things for communication, like for instance, is I'm showing you a statue, you know. Do you know whose statue this is? This is from Panjim. You could put in the chat box or you could tell on the mic. Whose statue is this? Who's this fellow? Must be an important guy because the old secretariat on one side is the first chief minister of Goa and on the other side is this guy. Two of them actually, but it's obviously the guy who's standing. Nobody knows about him. He's the most famous Goan internationally. All universities, all medical practitioners, psychologists, psychiatrists, counselors would tend to study about him.
Excuse me, can't see the statue.
Pardon?
The window is not open, sir.
You can't see it? You can't see this photo?
No, sir.
You're not presenting.
Okay. Sorry. Let me put for presenting again. Let's see. Now, can you? Whose statue is this? Okay, we have one answer. Okay, Abe Faria. All right, fine. Now, you know, why I'll tell you why I put up this statue, you know, because this is very close to a bus stop there and there are a lot of locals. You know, when I go and ask them, I grew up in Panjim, although I don't stay in Panjim, I stay in Porvari, but I still think I'm a Panjim guy. And, you know, like, I ask people, locals who stand at the bus stop, I said, who is this guy? And they don't know, you know, they say, we don't know. They shrug their shoulders or whatever. But tourists, you know, who are moving around there, and tourists are generally, you know, how you recognize a tourist in Goa is they wear this I love Goa t-shirts. You know, Goans don't wear those t-shirts. So the tourist, you go and ask them, like, who's this guy? And they can tell you. My question is, how can the locals not know who it is when they are looking at that statue maybe 5 times a week, at least, you know, like for maybe 40 weeks in a year? And how can the tourist who has just arrived recognize it? Know who it is about. How? Locals don't have the curiosity to know. Tourists have. It's a statue, you know, like, so I don't think tourists study about statues and come. They may study about which restaurants to go to or something like that, or which places to visit. But good, you know, Vibhav has answered. What about the others? How do they know? How would you know whose statue it is if you saw a statue? You went to some other state and you saw a statue. How would you know? Like I went to Uzbekistan and I found statues everywhere of one guy sitting on a horse. So, if it's, you know, like, how do I know who it is? It's written on the stone below. Okay, correct. All right. Below and every statue, you know, like it will be written whose statue it is. And this is a very important thing. Now, why I'm bringing this into entrepreneurship skills? There's a very fundamental entrepreneurship skill called visioning. So if I see a statue, I wonder whose statue it is. I'm not going to say I'm not bothered whose statue it is. I'll say I can see the statue all the time. I'm not going to know whose it is. So I will walk up close and I'll read it, you know, I'll read there. And this is very important. Entrepreneurs will have questions in their mind and they'll try to get the answers to them. And this skill of being able to see those questions and maybe then see the answers is based on something called visioning. Helen Keller said this very famously, a worse thing than not having sight would be to not have vision. Okay. So visioning are the skills that you need to look at. Now I'm putting a picture before you. You can type there. How many legs does this elephant have? You know, if you have to tell somebody that you saw this picture of an elephant with how many legs? Four. So if you told somebody you saw an elephant with four legs, they would see this in their mind's eye. Would they imagine this one? Five. Somebody said five. How many? Depends on the view. So you tell somebody, I saw something, it depends on the view. Now you imagine what you have to imagine. You have to tell, you have to describe. Visioning is not only about seeing. Visioning is about being able to tell what you saw. And transfer it in the same way as you saw it. I want you to look at the elephant closely and look at the ground line and you will realize that the feet are drawn between the gaps. So instead of telling that elephant had four legs, five legs, or God knows what stupid fellow that artist had done some mistake. If I tell somebody there was a picture of a standing elephant, but on ground, the artist had joined the feet in the wrong places. So the back of the trunk was connected to the front of the first leg by drawing a foot. In the gap of the first and second leg, a foot was drawn. In the gap between the second and third leg, a foot was drawn. A gap between the third and fourth leg, a foot was drawn. And also the fourth leg was completed. So it looked like the elephant had four legs, but on ground you could see 5 feet. Okay, because he had drawn in the gaps. So if you describe with so many words, the probability, you know, of the person seeing the same thing that you saw will increase. Okay. And that is what I want you to understand and remember. Okay. That if I can tell, okay, if I can tell that, describe it. But what we are used to, talking like, you know, single words. I remember once I was traveling, you know, when mobiles were new, I was traveling in the bus and somebody had a mobile, you know, people who had a mobile and most other people didn't have, they used to try to show off by speaking loudly. So, you know, in the bus, he was like, he was talking like this, you know, now everyone is disturbed, but nobody knows what he is talking about. But imagine somebody talking like this, you know. Hello, Rakesh, sang, kya hai? Accident, where hai? Bambole, GMC in Vatmar hai. Aatuka kai dao na, scooter damage, which hai? Activa, this 7982 re, black Activa. Whole bus is writing 7982, you know, they're writing the numbers. Then they'll use it for some purpose, maybe. So, but it's obvious, right? It's a description. You have to be able to describe, not single words. So visioning is about being able to describe, you know. Like I've been to restaurants, you know, where some people, you know, you go and ask them, what's today, what's special today? And they'll tell you, you know, they'll tell you in a particular way that you'll order that thing even if you normally don't eat it. You know, like, so suppose like you may not have a fancy for certain things, you know, like suppose like I don't fancy paneer much, but you know, if somebody comes and tell me, are you just try this paneer, it's like really, you know, like tandoori something we have done for it and this and that, you know, he tells me, he describes it, makes me excited in it, right? And that's very important, your ability to transfer what you know. It's not to, you know, like I'm not asking you to project something that's not true. What you know, what you see in your idea. And the most important thing is this is what you will have to tell to people who will invest in your business, to people who will help you, who will guide you. What's in your head, you'll have to be able to tell it well. And I like to give this example, you know, there was a man, young man who was working in the United States, and he had worked on two major projects with two corporations. You know, the corporations in the United States in those days also were very big. Okay, now we are seeing in India, we are seeing corporations become really big. You know, they became bigger than the government. So that time they were already there in America. And he had done two big projects, and it got a good name, fame, money. But he quit all that and he came back to India to work in his country. And he went to Gujarat. He went to a place called Anand, where Amul was based. And he went to meet Dr. Varghese Kurian. And he got a 5-minute appointment, you know. He had come with a project, you know, entrepreneurship idea. And he went into Kurian's cabin. He said, good morning, sir. My name is so-and-so. I've come from, you know, America. I've come back. You know, I've left everything there because of you. You know, I have been inspired by you. And not only me, all Indians, they are so proud of you because, you know, you have made us proud by what you have done here. The entire world looks up to India for, you know, what you've done to milk, the Operation Flood, the White Revolution. And, you know, he told all that, you know, it was like how he was inspired by Dr. Varghese Kurian. Secondly, he began to tell about the projects he had done, because that was also important. He had to tell that. So he explained one project, what he did, and, you know, like how it became successful. And then he began to started to explain the second project. And Dr. Kurian stopped him and told him, your time is up. 5 minutes are over. So this fellow said, like how we tell, you know, when we get exam papers, you know, the examiner says, time up. He says, get 2 minutes, 2 minutes. So he said, sir, give me 2 minutes more. He said, no. So I said, at least 30 minutes. No, get out. He threw him out. So he was very, very, you know, like disturbed. He had blown his opportunity, but he didn't give up. He kept going back. He used to sit in the lobby there. And, you know, like secretary would try to make him go away, but he wouldn't listen. He'd say, please tell sir, give me an appointment again. Please, please. And he was polite. He was persistent. So eventually, Dr. Varghese Kurian had pity on him after a few days, and he said, give him a 1 minute appointment. And this man, when the secretary told him, you got only 1 minute, 60 seconds, don't waste your time, get to the point fast. He said, I'm ready. I will not make the same mistake again. And he went in. He said, good morning, Dr. Kurian. I want to do to oil what you did to milk. So Kurian said, what? He said, I want to do to oil what you did to milk. So Kurian got angry. He said, can't I do to oil what I did to milk? Why do I require you? Just because you come from the United States, you think too much of yourself? Huh? She said, no, sir. Under your guidance, under the Amul umbrella, I want to do to oil what you have already successfully done to milk. So Kurian understood. So he said, you got a project report ready. He said, yes, sir, but I hardly have 30 minutes remaining. I don't think that will be enough. So he said, don't worry. He called his secretary and said, don't disturb us for 1 hour. He said, I'm giving you 60 minutes. Okay, not a 1 minute more, 10. And in less than 10 minutes, he was able to tell, actually. But he got those 10 minutes or, you know, the 60 minutes because he could tell in one line without telling. It was intriguing, actually. You know, it's called the elevator pitch. You know, if you are in an elevator with somebody and somebody asks you something, what is it that you would say that would be enough? Because, you know, anytime it's going to reach a floor and the elevator is going to open, right? So your time is going to be up. The person is going to walk away. What is it that will make that person interested in listening more from you or will give you an appointment to come and meet later? That is called an elevator pitch. And Dr. Jayant Chhaya, who said this line, I want to do to oil what you did to milk, got that project. And it was the second big story, success story of Amul. And that was called Dhara. Dhara cooking oil, you know, In those days, used to get cooking oil very rarely. It's to come in cans called Postman, and it's to be very expensive. The rates, it's to be sold in the black market, and most people couldn't get it. He changed the scenario. You can get as much cooking oil as you want. Not only of Dara, there are other cooperatives now. You can get as much oil as you want any time of the year. If you don't get it in one shop, you'll get it in another one. Right? And that is, now that is, that was a very successful business idea. But he got it because he was able to communicate it. But that is the vision. When I'm talking of visioning, I want to do to oil what you did to milk. Now, this isn't a tagline. This isn't an advertisement line. It could become one, but it is a visioning line, and it's called an elevator pitch. So what I will suggest is you should be able to, you know, like tell. And now, I'm not saying you should be able to tell in one line. Maybe you may take 3-4 lines, but not too many lines. If I have to tell what I want to do, you know. So if you know, like if somebody were to ask me, you know, like, what do you do, you know. And if I say I do training, it means there are so many other people who do training. I wouldn't say that, right? So I would say I help people connect to their passion and potential. And then somebody would ask me, how do you do that? So I said, by taking them into experiential situations, especially in the outdoors. And what is that? So it's called outbound training. What do you do in outbound training? So I said, I take them to forest. You know, like now the person keeps asking me. Rather than me tell, you know, like, you know, I do training, you know, I do experiential training, and, you know, like I have programs, this, that, you know, and that is like communication. You have to be able to get into a conversation with your investors, with your customers, with your team. And that is communication. So you have to be able to project that. So to be able to describe. But not in length, briefly. You know, I could get into that elephant description in great detail, you know. You know, that proportion of that elephant, that paper was, you know, I think 6x4 proportion, and that elephant was played. Those are unnecessary details, right? I just need to get to the point fast. And that is going to be very important. The second thing besides visioning, which is important, is listening. Okay? Listening, being able to understand. To understand, you should be able to listen. Learn to listen, listen to learn. Okay, so I would recommend very clearly that these two qualities you should you know, like, develop yourself. You should be able to bring to focus both these aspects. Now I'll move to the next important thing. So let me get into presenting again. So where I will, you know, like, put in some more points. I hope you can see the slides. So we are going to get into how to manage the resources. Fine. So the first part, what is profit? What according to you is profit? We said, you know, you do some activity, you design, launch and run it, you take whatever risks are required because you want profit. So what is the profit? What is profit in a entrepreneurship? You could write it in the chat box or you could tell on the mic. What is profit? I'm almost asking what you want from the success of your entrepreneurship idea. When it gets implemented, what is it that you want? What is profit? I hope you're around, because nobody's writing anything. Fame. Okay, good one. You want to be famous. So to be famous, you need to be, you know, like, really up there, right? You'll become famous if you can give sponsorship and all to people. So you have to have a lot. Financial freedom, okay? Means you want a lot of money. Okay. Want money. Money, fame, gain, you know. No, no, I'm asking what is profit? Using profit to multiply the startup? No, I'm asking what? Money is profit? Fame is profit? What is? What is you would identify as profit besides money and fame? Trust. Networking, growth, okay. Yeah, I'm good. I basically wanted you to be on the line. You have put most of the things right, but I'll put them all over again now. Money is something that you want, but look at it now, this assets. You know, sometimes money may not be coming in. You know, I went through a particular phase, you know, when I had to step back from my business and people who were running my business were not doing it too well. I had to step back for a personal reason. My mother used to not keep well. I had to look after her. And I was doing work from home there, some, you know, like 11 years back. And so the money began to reduce. I wasn't, in fact, for around more than a year or so, I did not travel outside Goa at all. And I used to do a lot of big programs outside Goa, and my team would be running the programs in Goa. But I had assets, I had equipment, I had sound systems, I had, you know, like activity materials and all, which I started giving out on rent. I had a godown, which I did not require. I went for a smaller godown and was able to sell that other godown. You know, like I needed, like, but I had assets, I had a vehicle. So what you have, then this is what I want you to remember. So whatever, in fact, you know, all this EDC or the EDC gives us Chief Minister's Rozgar Yojana loan. There is a Prime Minister's Rozgar Yojana loan, and you know, like all these loans, or even banks, when they give you loans for doing business, they give it against assets. Okay, remember that. So that is profit. Your brand positioning. You know, Yahoo was just a small little company. Hotmail was a small little company, but they, you know, like eventually they were sold. You know, Hotmail was sold by Sameer Bhatia for millions of dollars. You know, it became a this thing. Because right now we don't hear of Hotmail, but that time it was a hot media platform. So you know, like people can buy your brand. In fact, when my business was on the, you know, like. Slowdown when I was working from home, and you know, then a lot of people left, and you know, I went through a lot of what you'd say problems. There were many people who approached me to buy my brand, you know, from other states. They're ready to buy the brand, my company, with the logo and with the type of positioning it had and the branding. So that was profit for me. You know, I could actually sell that. Your team, somebody spoke about, you know, this thing, what you call trust and things like that, that I would put under the team. So team would be of different types, but I will talk about only one type right now. And that is your, you know, like internal team, you know, the people who work with you. Okay, so they could be working directly for you, or they could be working occasionally for you, not a problem. But you need to, so if you have a large team, it is a profit, no? Like it is a matter of pride, no? How much you are paying, how many salaries you are paying, and all that. Reach, where are you? Are you only, if you, you know, like you can anticipate that you are starting something in one place, but you know, I met a lot of people who are in their, when they have been students in college, they have started businesses which have been around the world. Okay, and they were already getting returns by the time they were in college, and by the time they are out of college, they were like very big businessmen. Well, this is reach, you know, and this is, you know, like beauty. Like you don't need to work only for a small area. I'm not saying you necessarily have to be selling in other countries, you know, but you can at least imagine that you are not going to be only in the place where you are. So even if I have a restaurant, say in Margaon, all right, I will want people from all over Goa at least to come to the restaurant, right? So that type of a reach. So reach is in different ways. One is to be at many places, and to have people from away also come to you. Okay. So what the online and things do is they allow other people to also get. Like for instance, if you're into anything that is crafts, products, art, this, that, you can sell it all over the place. All over the world, you can sell it. Nation building, what I've already talked about, but the most important, many of you mentioned, achieving your dream. Okay? Achieving your dream. Now, I have not put fame here. I have not put other things. Why? No, they will come, but they are not so important. In fact, I have seen a lot of people getting distracted by fame. Okay? So, like, I'll give an example, you know. There are people who will create Facebook pages or they'll create something, you know, or they'll try to get an interview in the newspapers or, you know, something like that. They'll try to project it like there are some people even who buy awards and all, thinking that that fame will be good enough. But eventually there's a lot of, yes, you know, I'm not saying PR will not help you, but what is your real, you know, like main thing is your product or service, your what you are selling to them. That is the most important thing. All right. Profit will come if you're professionally fit. Okay, so keep that in mind. Be professional about it. You know, don't you know, like look at customer satisfaction and things like that. Somebody spoke about, you know, like how the money remains. You know, this is just, I'm giving you a small little concept that profit is selling price minus cost price, right? So selling price is not in your control. Depends on competition. If competition is selling for less, sometimes you are also forced to sell for less. So only choice you have is to reduce cost price. Now cost price is based on purchase plus overheads plus taxes. Okay. Now of this, obviously the most simple thing is don't pay your taxes, right? But it's a dangerous thing. You can end up losing the license of your business and you can get into various problems. Okay. So you cannot avoid taxes. But what you can definitely, you know, tackle the factors are these two factors of purchase and overheads. Whatever you're purchasing, you have to find out from where you can get it for better quality and for more economical cost. And overheads are the things you need to spend otherwise, you know. So, and there are little things, you know, that if you keep that down, you know, you're basically every penny saved is a penny earned. Remember that. Now, this is the last concept that I'm putting up before you to growing your business. You know, like you will have to identify who will be your customers. Now, this won't be immediately, okay? But you can start this process now because a lot of people, when they get into business, you don't get the time to do this. You know, so to create a what is called a customer database, in that same book that you have, you know, maybe from the backside, you know, you start writing first all friends, you know. So not you just write the name, you write the number, okay? Then you write people, your relatives. Now, you know your relatives will say, I know my friends, but you may not, you know, like eventually go and tell them what it is about. Organizations, you know, Lions, Rotary, some social club, some cultural club or whatever. Geographic, where you stay. Okay. What is there? Or even like, I would put even like where your institution is. You know, there would be some things nearby that you keep frequenting. So that geographic for you. And then there are your social contact. Now, this could be maybe even people whom you don't know, but you're connected with them by occasional some contact or, you know, like you know them socially. So you make that list also. Basically, this customer database is one you'll reach out to once your setup is ready, right? Maybe from some of these, you may also get support. Investment support, you may get, you know, like other forms of support. So you create this type of a database. Last two things actually. And then Konkani is saying, you know, don't want any pie, dorong zaina. You cannot keep your feet in two canoes. Can you? Can you keep your feet in two canoes? Yes? No. Right? You must move around because in Goa, at many places, they take two canoes, three canoes, four canoes, put planks on them and create what is called a sangod. Okay. Now, the sangod is a platform that can take more capacity. If a canoe can take in, say, 10 people, a sangod of four canoes will take 80, 90 people. You know, it won't take 40. the buoyancy increases and the capacity increases. Basically, what I'm trying to say is you have to, as an entrepreneur, put your feet in more canoes than one. And which are those canoes? There could be more than this, but I'm talking of the principal five canoes that you should create a sandboard of. The first one is your internal customers. Internal customers are people who work for you either directly or indirectly. Okay. So they could be your paid employees, they could be your contract employees, they could be your associates, they could be your suppliers, all those fellows, you know, like you can start looking at, not suppliers actually, but, you know, like people who associate with you and things. External customers are the ones who will be coming and buying from you, you know. So they are the ones who will pay you for whatever your product or service. Then alliances, you know, like associates and all would come in over here, you know, like people who give you resources, who give you finance, who investors, all that would be there. And I put a word in the brackets against each of them, and I'll come to all those words. Associations. You should be part of association. So now you can just start finding out about association. You may even go and attend in those programs. Like suppose you're getting into some, say, cakery, you know, bakery type of thing. If there's a baker's association in Goa, go and, you know, like try and find out. They are the people who can guide you. They can help you. They can tell you what are the norms, licenses, so many things they can help you on. And the last is your community. Okay. This, of course, will come more once you start your entrepreneurship starts. But you can start thinking about it now. The internal customers, you have to build your team. From external customers, you have to get testimonials. You have to collect, you know, like, you know, if they're happy and they have something nice to say, you need to start collecting this, you know. It happened to me after 3 or 4 years of running my business. One day somebody asked me, can you give a testimonial? And, you know, I began to ask a lot of my happy clients, you know, corporates. And they said, yeah, we'll send you. And, you know, it would take a long time because, but, you know, like after that, you know, what I would do once the program was over, I would tell them, can you send me a testimonial? What you felt about the program? And, you know, they would send me a good one and I would keep it, you know. So if you ask somebody later, no, they may not give or they may be busy, they may procrastinate, but you need. With alliances, you start collaboration. Alliances can be, you know, like of different types, you know, like for instance, now I have people in Mumbai, you know, who collaborate with me. I have people in Panvel. Like suppose, I, you know, like last December, I had done a training program in Panvel. Now I had somebody there who organized volunteers for me for, you know, activities. I was doing a lot of what are called sports type of activities in team building. So I required referees and, you know, I required marksmen and things like that. People to, you know, like this thing. They had 8 teams. So I required 8 people. Now I couldn't carry 8 people from here to there. You know, it would be too expensive for me, but I could get 8 people from there. Now this works because there's an alliance. Okay. So I have alliances there. Then, you know, like associations, you know, like we didn't have a association of trainers. So I started a trainers association. Besides that, I participate in the Goa Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I take part in other activities also, other associations like, you know, like which are even non-government organizations and things like that. So, you know, like all these things, participation in it helps. And community for CSR, PR, you know, community, corporate social responsibility and PR, you can involve this thing. The last thing that I'm putting up before you, before I take your questions, is a stamp that you see, California Gold Rush. You know, there was a lot of gold mining that was happening in California. And there was one person who had bought a mine because he knew that there was gold underneath. And he took some loans to buy the land. Then he took some more loans to, you know, get equipment and workers. And they started digging and digging and digging. And they went quite deep and they didn't get gold. So this guy got scared and he said, I have done a mistake. I need to get out of this mistake. So he sold the land for cheap, gave that money to the bank, but he still owed the bank much more. So he started working, you know, he started taking in a lot of odd jobs and decided to slog and make up for his mistake and, you know, repay whatever he owed anybody. Whoever bought that land from him started digging and in 3 feet, they got gold. Immediately, and 3 feet. Can you imagine what this man must have felt? When this was happening, his nephew was observing this, and his nephew eventually became the number one insurance seller of America. And this is something that he has recounted, R.U. Darby. He told that I stopped 3 feet from gold, but I'll never stop because men say no when I ask them to buy insurance. What he's saying is, I wouldn't give up. Entrepreneurship, the difficult part in entrepreneurship is only being able to have the courage to continue. It's not a short-term thing. You know, if I plant a seed, no, I don't keep on removing it out again and again to see what is happening to it, right? I allow it, the sapling to come up. I allow it to become a tree. And maybe after 3 years or 4 years, I'll get the fruit, right? And I need to have patience for that. I should know it. In some businesses, you start earning fast. Okay, you can earn quite immediately, but maybe not much, but you start earning. So you can have some profit immediately. In some, it takes some time. You should be aware of this. You should not give up. Too many people give up on entrepreneurship when it will going to bear fruit. Imagine you have a mango tree, you plant a mango tree, take a trouble for 3-4 years, and then you get like bored of it and you sell it to somebody. And that person starts getting the fruit of it. This has happened in a lot of cases that I've seen. Do not give up. That is the message. Okay? Entrepreneurship is not, that's what, don't focus on money alone. Don't focus on assets alone. Focus on all those things that we looked at profit. But the most important thing was right down there, achieving your dream. You should be ready to go through the struggle to achieve your dream. There'll be ups and downs in entrepreneurship, but that's part of the game. You should love to play a game. You know, you can't play a sport if you're not ready to lose. Yes, you must play to win. But you're not going to win all the time, right? Or some things are going to go wrong. You're going to get injured or something like that. Some things are going to happen, like say in sports. Similarly, in business, things, government policies can change what you are, this thing. You may have to diversify your business. You may have to change track. You will have to do things. Do whatever needs to be done, but don't give up. That's a message. Okay? So I'll take any questions that you have. You can ask me any questions. Yes. Any questions? Don't let anyone tell you that, you know, it will take you a long time to get into entrepreneurship or something like that. This is a good time. Any time is a good time. Only when you start it, you know, you should have fleshed it out well. To flesh it out well, to, you know, like really have a good plan, it doesn't take too many days, right? But don't be in a hurry, but don't be in a, this thing, what you call, slow down as well. Don't make it very slow. I'll do it later. Don't do that. No? Because you may suddenly get opportunity. And there are a lot of young people, you know, like I know some people in Canada, I know them in Africa, you know, of Indian origin, of Goan origin, who are young and who are into very big time thing. And they, you know, like suppose you want to do something there, they'll help you. There'll be a lot of people who'll help you. Talk to your teachers, talk to your friends. And one thing, you know, like I'll say this, you know, especially if somebody's talking to you about an idea, no, try to, you know, like be developmental. Don't be judgmental. No, it won't work. You see how it can work. If somebody is saying, you know, that he wants to do, say, something, like, you know, anything. It may be even art or craft or something that they can do with their hands. Look at how it can be turned into a business project. Please ask me questions, if any. You can put your mics on, you can put your videos on, ask, not a problem. Yeah, I'll always keep around 10 to 12 minutes for this part where you can ask me and get answers. I may not have answers of everything, but I worked with a lot of entrepreneurs. How does an entrepreneur differ from a businessman or both? They are almost same. An entrepreneur, we use an entrepreneur for somebody who's starting off. Okay. So once he starts flourishing, he's a businessman. So So like the loans that come from the Chief Minister's Rozgar Yojana or the Prime Minister, they come for only fresh entrepreneurs, you know, first timers. They, of course, like EDC does have loans, say, for existing businessmen also, but they are of a different category. These entrepreneurship loans which are there are generally for people who are starting off. Okay. The word that is used is called a startup. That is one word. Another thing is a first generation business person or a somebody who is setting out. Now, it's quite possible that your family is into business, but what you are starting now may be new, right? So it will be treated as a new business as long as it's in your name and things like that. But basically, you're a businessman. Okay. You may have a small gado. You may be going door to door. You may even this thing. Like I know there was one lady, you know, who does Puran Police, you know, from Mapsa. And I just guided her a bit and she was able to get much more business done by being able to position in a particular way. So yeah, that distinct, you know, what I wanted to tell, Puran Police is now slightly different from other people. They are thin. Kids love them. Young people love them. Everybody loves them. You know, the, I mean, like I'm not seen such thin Puran Police. So I told her to, you know, make it even more thinner as possible, because that was the attraction. There's a restaurant chain called Tato. They have Sukhi Bhaji, which where the potatoes are chopped very finely. Now, some other people also have been attempting to do that. And they do that also, but it will be still, you know, if you see potato bhaji with very small potatoes, cut potatoes, you will say Tato Bhaji. They actually turned it into a brand, you know. So whether it's somebody running from the house or whatever, eventually it's a business. But when you're starting it off, it's entrepreneurship. Because a business person could be an existing business person, right? Who's just diversifying his business or is entering into a new territory, a new business and things like that. That's a different thing. Entrepreneurship is where you are starting off. Fine, Aditya? Any other questions?
Sir, this is Aditya. Hello, sir.
Yes. Yes.
So in case if some of my students would like to talk with you a little later, or you know, get in touch with you, is it okay if I share your email ID with them?
Yeah, I don't mind, but I have a, you know, like caution on this.
Okay. That,
they should be able to tell what they want to do.
Okay.
Because otherwise, no, it is general talking, you know, like this session is just okay. Information for you actually.
Yes. But,
you know, if anyone, what I asked at the start, I waited, you know, almost for 30 seconds, you know, if somebody wants to help, because if you have something, you know, we can help in this same time, maybe even we can help you.
Okay.
So, you know, if please feel free, I'll be most happy to help anybody, but come with your idea.
Okay.
You should know what you want to do. Like suppose you want to grow plants maybe, you know, and sell plants.
Okay.
Or you want to, you know, like, solve some problem in a village. Mm-hmm. Again, I'll repeat this, you know, identify a problem that you can solve. That is entrepreneurship. Simple. Oh. If you don't have ideas, then start looking at problems around and they'll give you an idea. You should also have passion for it. Okay. Like now I do outbound training. I have a passion for it. I'm ready to get up early in the morning. I'm ready to, you know, like climb on trees and do all the hard work, pull the ropes. You know, I have team members who do that right now, you know, but I will also be there. Now over the years, like I don't really need to go and start tying the ropes and all that, but I will be there. Why? Because I love it and I can do it, you know. And if somebody is unavailable for some particular reason, I will enter into it because I love it. So people in the restaurants, they love that, you know, they love feeding people. They may be good cooks or they may not be cooks also, but they love that feeding. So they have a passion for it. You must have a passion for it. Then, you know, you won't bother too much about other things. Like sometimes, you know, like money will be less, sometimes assets will be less, or whatever happens, you know, because you're enjoying, you're doing what you want. And that will make you earn better, actually. You know, you'll be more effective when you are happier. So just look around for problems, identify problems, what solution, and then just say, okay, would I love to do that? If I would, then that's your business idea.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Students, any more questions? Do you have any more questions?
In fact, you would have more questions if you had the idea in your head.
Yeah.
So I do, you know, like I'll give an example, you know, when I do it, say, for EDC, all those people now have applied for a loan whom I'm training. Okay. So they applied for a loan. Obviously, they have applied for something. Somebody is for a taxi, somebody for a dental clinic, somebody for a grocery van, or somebody for a, you know, like a restaurant or whatever. They have applied for it. They know what they are come for. So it becomes very easy to help them out. So even if you're telling them about branding, positioning and things like that, that becomes very, very easy for them. One of the things in branding that I would recommend is you create your visiting card. And when I mean by visiting card, we are living in technological times. You need it on this as well. Soft copy. And something you can send on various social media to somebody, you know, like you can send by email, you can send by WhatsApp or whatever format you're using. But you need to have that card, you know, which says something about it. So that's where now on the card, you'll have to put some name for it. Right, you'll have to this thing. So you know you need to get your branding done. In fact, once you start actually running your business, no, you may not have time for any of this. But now, when you're growing your business, you're developing your business idea. This is the time to look at, you know, play around with those things. You know, like talk to your artist friends, or you know, you can have your own ideas and you can talk to some artist friends and try to talk to everybody, you know, who would listen to you. Okay, and listen to their feedback, take note. You may not agree with them, but take note of it because maybe it could be something important that somebody is telling you without even you realizing it. Talk to people from the business, get mentoring, you know, get people to guide you, mentor you, and learn as fast as possible about all procedures, that what I said about safety, you know, taking protection. You need to know all procedures, licenses, GST, for instance. Will you be eligible for GST? Does it make sense to go for GST? So it's like that. So do not ignore this part at all. Any questions? We got a couple of minutes. Or once you have your business idea, you can keep in touch with me. Not a problem. Okay. Talk to your teachers. Talk to people. Talk to people from the same business. Talk. In fact, you know, when you speak, I always say this, you know, when you speak, you sometimes hear your own thoughts also, because, you know, they may just be in your head. You know, when you're telling somebody, they come out. So ideas in your head. And whenever you get something, start putting that book thing, you know, is very important. It could be any this thing. You can also do it on your notebook on the tab or on the mobile or something like that. But the book for me, you know, is I find that exciting. Investing in real estate. Okay. Now, if you have a passion for it, okay, I'll make it again clear. Real estate is a very big returns business. So you get a lot of money on real estate, but it is also it is a swinging business. Okay, but if you have a passion for it, you don't mind it, no, then you can. Stock market is about investing. I wouldn't call it a business unless you know you are you know, like I would put it as an add-on, you know, like one thing, whatever you do in business, you know, you need to have what is called passive income besides your business, you know, not immediately, but once your business starts running, some of the money from the profits that you get, you should start putting them into something So even at this age, you can get into stocks and investments and things like that. But decide on a particular amount. This is the amount I'm going to do. Play with, you know. Suppose like I'm just saying, you know, I got some 30,000 or 40,000. I'll play with this amount. Okay, I will not put any more money into it, at least for a couple of years. So that's how I'll say. But it's for passive income. It's not by itself an entrepreneurship. But entrepreneurs can, like, you know, like I recommend you to go in for assets, go in for properties or whatever, like, you know, invest in that. So that becomes your passive income. It will always help you. But good questions. I like the questions. In real estate, for instance, no, like I'll give an example. There are some people, you know, who are into what you'd say, consultancy brokers. They are brokers, real estate agents, you know. But some of them are very well organized. You know, they have, I'll give you an analogy. You go to a doctor, you know, you go to a doctor's clinic, and you know, some clinics, you know, they're like outside there, you know, it's quite messy, it's dusty, and the magazines are, you know, like 2 years old, newspapers are 2-3 months back. Whatever you're reading is all dated. Okay, and it's quite this thing. But there are some doctors, you know, like when you go there, you know, the lobby is very nice. You have today's newspapers, you have this week's magazine, this month's magazines. You have a nice television set there. You have a fridge there. The toilet is very nice. They are looking after the customers, right? Now, the first guy is just a professional. He's not an entrepreneur. The second guy is displaying entrepreneurship attitude. So he's looking at comfort of the customer. He's looking at customer satisfaction. Professionals don't look at customer satisfaction, very frankly. But entrepreneurs do. You know, so if you're doing something, say, even, you know, like that could become an entrepreneurship. But entrepreneurship essentially is not alone. This is another thing. Good you asked that question. It's not something you do alone. You may start alone, but eventually you need to have people working for you. I'll tell you why. You have to be free to grow your business. You can't be running your business all the time. Right? The other people should run your business. So you need to hire people and you should be free to grow your business. You should have time to grow your business and you also plan B then. Like, you know, suppose there is somebody, you know, like suppose you are running a restaurant and, you know, you have a manager and the manager goes away, you are there. Your plan B. The manager is going on leave. You are there. You are available to do the things that he's doing. Right? But remaining times you'll be looking at how you can grow the business. How you can get more investment, how you can increase the customers, how you can do the marketing, how you can open at other places and things like that. So feel free to, you know, like develop your business. But main thing, I'll repeat that again. I presume you will talk to each other. Do not discourage somebody, okay, of what they are talking about. If they turn into big entrepreneurs and big businessmen, sometime later in life, you'll regret the fact that you made fun of them. So don't be in that position. These are dreamers. Entrepreneurs are dreamers. They have a large heart. They're ready to take risk. They're ready to do it because they love it. They have a passion for it. Such people are, you know, like totally, I mean, they are people to be admired. You know, you have to pick up the attitude. And even suppose you don't want to be an entrepreneur, at least you can be support to an entrepreneur. And, you know, who knows, maybe we'll join them later as part of their team or even on board, you know, as a partner or something like that. You have opportunity. So never, never discourage somebody who's talking of a dream. It may look impossible, but I've seen a lot of entrepreneurs who have had remarkable success in areas where it looked like there would be nothing. So all the best to all of you. You can communicate with me. But like I said, I would prefer that I'll ask you that. You'll have to tell me or I'll ask you the question. What is the business idea you're talking about? Because it has to be specific to that. There is trading, there is manufacturing, there is service, you know, there is agro, everything. There's different sectors. It's not the same for everybody. It is different. But by itself, it's not difficult. You know, if you take help, you take guidance and you do it the proper way, it's not a difficult thing. The only difficult thing in entrepreneurship is it has to be from your heart. You should have a passion for it. You should not give up. You should do it. So I wish, you know, like many of you could be your own boss. All the best to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request Aditya. Aditya?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
Please propose a vote of thanks.
Yeah. I would like to thank Praveen Sabnis for this wonderful session, giving us insights and sharing his experiences about entrepreneurship. And I would also like to thank the members of the ESL committee for organizing this session for us, aspiring entrepreneurs. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, so much. Thank you.